We believe that attractiveness comes from the belief in determinism. And this is not so. The world is actually entirely unattractive, really. This is a realization that can dawn. And you have to take it the right way. Instead of getting all depressed and despondent and freak out, just say, okay, just full stop in that. Don't struggle with the struggle. So lately I've been realizing the world is fundamentally unattractive. Fundamentally, and you cannot make it attractive. We struggle to try and make this mirage of determinism attractive. It's not attractive. And it's not difficult to see that it's not attractive. It's just we're so determined to make it attractive and so scared that, hey, maybe it's not attractive. So scared of that. So we tend to string thoughts together like a path, like a spiritual path even, and to keep it going, trying to make it determinate, trying to believe that I have momentum from the past that's pushing me into the future, and I'm going to succeed in this way, and I'm going to succeed to make this attractive. It doesn't work. And so this is to get to this point, to see the world as unattractive is not easy. I'm struggling a little bit. I'm sort of looking like maybe I should get depressed, maybe I should get suicidal, maybe I should just say forget it, just end this all, this is just horrible. And then say no, this let us just don't struggle with it. And today, more and more and more, I'm getting this fundamental clarity about the non-duality, and seeing just the heart of the delusion, and you know, just noticing it. I said, okay, I'm just noticing it. It's becoming more and more clear to me. And with that comes the realization the world is not attractive at all. In fact, it's repulsive, very repulsive. I was looking at some videos on YouTube, and it's just so repulsive. I can't bear to watch bodies at all, and people, and nature, and all this stuff. It's utterly repulsive. To the nth degree. Now, how can we live in such a situation without being completely repulsed by it? Well, recognizing the complete indeterminacy of everything, experiencing God everywhere, somehow that may, we're told it redeems the whole situation. It no longer seems so horrible. Nothing is permanent. Nothing is determinate. Everything is inherently released right now from the appearance that it's appearing, the release is already inherent. Its release is inherent. So you see the inherent release of all this appearance, and somehow that changes your experiencing. Oh, this is the testimony of the great teacher, so I'll certainly trust what they say. So therefore, I'm not panicking. Just say, okay, let's just keep the discipline going here. So certainly, we get to the point where we just feel this revulsion for this place. In fact, it's always there. It's just horrible, really. And I know we frantically try and generate some enthusiasm for the world, but it's a vain. It's attempted in vain. So it's better to focus on, hey, what happens when I recognize how repulsive the world is? What then? So we better prepare for that. And then shift perspective to the non-dual perspective, the indeterminate perspective, non-dual. There's not two moments joined together. It's not moment one and moment two. It's always moment zero. it's zero sum. There's an absolute zero sum constantly taking place. And somehow, that, again, that transforms our how we feel. But if we take this world to be a determinate appearance, it is absolutely repulsive, and we will, you know, get into the sex, drugs, and rock and roll mode, and materialism, the corporate princess culture, desperately trying to put lipstick on a pig. And as long as we're obsessed with the lipstick, what shade is the lipstick? What's the gloss on the lipstick? You know, we keep trying to be obsessed by that and not see the pig. But when you're honest about it, you see the world, say, oh my God, it's a pig. You know, it's this filthy, muddy pig. And we got this smeary lipstick on it. How gross. How absolutely gross. Totally gross place. And then you just, okay, wow. Just be indeterminate about it. So this morning when I was having this clarity about what is the heart of resistance to non-dual abidance, seeing it very clearly, I realized this was going to cause a severe burn, maybe the worst burn ever. So I'm into that phase of feeling, you know, despondent, somewhat despondent. Been battling that all day. And the key is that is to just, again, don't struggle with the struggle, full stop in the now. So I'm practicing what I'm preaching. I have to. It's not a joke. The spiritual path is not a joke. You have to have the simple technique and use it. Otherwise, the despondency has no. You'll lose all reference, point of reference, and you'll be engulfed by it. And then you will desperately try to make the world appear attractive to you. All the while inside, knowing is futile, which just makes things worse, actually. So you might say that really becoming very spiritually practiced is the antithesis of depression. It's evaporating depression. It's evaporating the determinist perspective. So I take all this very seriously. It's extremely serious stuff. Depression, despondencies, suicidal feelings, all that is not a joke. That is very serious business. And so this discipline that you must practice every day, so important, is what gets you through and gets you free of this. Those who just rely on pills, they don't have any discipline, you know. They're still dependent on some pill. It's horrible. All the side effects, etc. So I'm not running for some pill or anything like that. I'm just saying, oh, great. Here comes the burn. Excellent. I just smile, relax, full stop in the burn. And welcome it. Thank you. This is great. Love it. So you end up having this negative feeling, but a positive feeling about the negative feeling here. An optimistic, hopeful, positive feeling about the severe despondency. You see, instead of panicking and intellectually trying to produce a concatenation of thought and inquiry and struggle. No struggle with it. Not trying to do anything with it. Indeterminate about it. Just completely indeterminate about it. It will resolve. I find that the spiritual practice, like walking towards somewhere that's dark and scary and everything, but you have a little flashlight here, you know. And if you're looking too far ahead, you're going to panic and think, oh, it's so dark there, I'm going to freak out. But if you look at your flashlight and right where it's pointing towards, you say, oh, the light is with me. When I get down the path, it'll still be with me, and this darkness will not be so dark. It will vanish. The light will vanish it. So I'm trying to have the attitude of, hey, this is great. This is great. This is wonderful. It's great I feel so miserable. That means this is the burn that's coming from dropping the concatenation, which just means a chain of thought or events, and most of the thought, a chain of consideration, a determinant chain, whether the consideration is spiritual or non-spiritual. We're just resting in indeterminacy, no chain. Could say Devachan is devoid of chain. Devoid of chain. The land of devoid of chain. And so we really don't label the symptoms, pay much attention, just remain indeterminate. Not grasping at trying to find some attractiveness. Because we have faith that when we can detach from this chain, concatenation of effort, then we can realize the true indeterminacy of all. And this will fundamentally change how we feel. Have faith in this. Have faith. This is what all the great teachers have told us. So I'm just saying, okay, I know this will happen. I don't feel good now at all, but that's okay. Enjoy the feeling bad like this. Enjoy the evaporation. So there's definitely this burn of consternation. We simply have to get used to effectively evaporating this. No point in struggling with it. Because what you're essentially saying is, I'm going to set down this concatenation. I've seen it. I've recognized it. I don't need it. I don't want it. And so this is causing, of course, a reaction. Absolutely. Because once you see it, you say, oh, okay, that's a trick. I'm not going to fall for that anymore. And then you start getting worried. Like, oh my gosh, what have I seen? What am I going to do? Oh my gosh. That's a continuity fear. So just let it evaporate. In other words, don't lose your confidence. Basically, you've seen the next move you're going to make, and it's a profound one, and now you're reacting, realizing, oh my gosh, I'm going to make this move, I'm going to make this move, I'm going to make this shift. And panic tries to seize hold of you. and get you to change your mind. But I say, oh, okay, I feel scared, I feel agitated, consternation, and the burn is there. Great, 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 wonderful. Don't try to make it more, don't try to make it less, just remain indeterminate with it. Don't try to diagnose it, label it, treat it. It's just the continuity fear. Don't try to get rid of it. Don't say it's irrational, or don't label it at all. Just remain indeterminate with it. This maximizes the evaporation of it. So, from my standpoint, this is essential on the path, because you will have breakthroughs, for sure, huge breakthroughs, which lead to seeing, oh my gosh, I can make another one now. And then that's when the continuity fear kicks in. You'll see, oh wow, look at my freedom, look at this, I can get there. Continuity fear will kick in, for sure. Now, it may seem that ignorance is bliss, and those who don't have any breakthroughs at all may seem do not have this burn so much, right? But they remain in extreme ignorance, subject to all the vagaries and fears of that ignorance. So at some point you have to set ignorance aside, start having the breakthrough, start having the clarity, and pay the price of that, and learn to accept the price, willingly pay it. Don't panic. Don't get pulled into panic at all. Don't get pulled into reaction at all. So someone says, how do you feel? Wow, intense misery. They say, you don't look like it. No, I'm enjoying it. This is great. It's an evaporation here, process taking place. It's funny, you know, nobody's really ever offered me any sort of solace or anything in my life. I've been in just one of intense misery. I guess I'm doing a great job of dealing with it properly, because I guess nobody seems to think I'm in any misery at all. See? So, you don't expect any help that way. Be willing to take on the challenge. It's like climbing a high mountain. You get tired, you get harder to breathe. So you're struggling with breathing, but you know that means you're really getting very, very high altitude, right? So you say, oh, this is great. I struggle with my breathing. That's tremendous. Happy to suffer this, because that means I'm nearing the top of the mountain. So whatever your situation is, don't struggle with it. Be happy that you're having this situation. This is a practice that Jesus recommends, is gratitude for what your situation, that it's exactly as you want it to be. And for that misery, have gratitude for the misery, to be happy for happy. Say, wow, this is great. This is wonderful. Really, really making great progress here. Nearing the top of the mountain. Don't struggle with it. I mean, realizing that the world is not beautiful at all is, that's really quite a profound realization. It's like, uh-oh. And, you know, just being honest about it. Realize that this is a wretched place. It's a garbage dump. And we can only fool ourselves so long. It's like photography, images, and music. Now, don't really do anything for me. Realize, oh, it's just, it's not really that attractive at all. In fact, it's not attractive. We try to fool ourselves with photography, but if you really look at stuff, it's like, wow, what a garbage dump I'm living in. Even in the finest homes, etc., it's a garbage dump. You're surrounded, it's everywhere. Dusty, disintegrating garbage dump. It does get redeemed by shifting to the indeterminate realization, the non-dual realization. Then there's a completely different perspective. And there's the inherency of everything is felt. The inherent greatness of reality is then experienced. And nothing diminishes that at all. Very different perspective. So, what a great practice to be able to practice with your despair, your revulsion, your depression, your angst, your misery, and turn it into a positive. You get lemons, you make lemonade. So that's what we're doing here. We've got these very sour lemons, but we're making lemonade. We're pouring the sugar into it. And it says, wow, this tastes great. The sourness is still there, right? This must be bringing about tremendous evaporation. Fantastic. Fantastic. This is wonderful. But we're not pretending that there isn't misery. No. That's why this practice is so important. You don't go around smiling at everybody and say, oh, I'm so happy. And I said, no, I'm miserable. I'm incredibly miserable. Everything is completely ugly and unattractive. It's misery, but I'm happy. To be realizing this misery and how ugly everything is, how ugly determinism is. Great, but I still feel terrible. But that's wonderful, because I'm evaporating this continuity fear around this issue. Yeah, a sane culture will celebrate this. This is, they're not trying to make the world beautiful. That's the most ridiculous endeavor ever. trying to make this world beautiful is the most ridiculous and crazy endeavor ever. There's nothing you can do about the repulsiveness of this world. Absolutely nothing anyone can do about it. And the more you try, the more repulsive it becomes, truly. It's like a really bad, sick joke. You know, people trying to make themselves look attractive. That's just such a sick joke. You know, it's like, wow. It's just, you know, exponentially repulsive. This is, again, it's like putting lipstick on a pig and saying, look how beautiful this all is now. The more you do, it's better just to see the pig or see the ugliness of the world and just say, okay, it's ugly, it's a fact, that's fine. I can handle that. But dressing it up, you know, with some lipstick and saying, see, that fixed it, that fixed it. Ah, that's sick. Very sick. I was in the Social Security office. I hate going to any governmental office. It's like, wow. Everybody in there is just looking at everybody. It's like, wow. You know, you feel the weight of of this world, the ugliness, the suffering, the misery. Holy cow. Just desperate people living desperate lives. How beautiful is that? No, it's repulsive. Just seeing any bodies at all is really completely repulsive. But again, it's spiritually, you make lemonade out of it, you see. So modern plague, you know, we talk about historic plagues like the bubonic plague, typhoid, cholera, smallpox, tuberculosis, malaria, bird flu, Ebola, on and on and on. The worst, you know, way worse than that is the spiritual plague of lack of a culture of spiritual attainment, where we're told that seeing how repulsive the world is a state of depression. We have no tools to deal with it. So it does lead to what we clinic depression if we're stripped of a culture of attainment, spiritual attainment. So stripping the world of a culture of spiritual attainment is guaranteed to lead to a crisis of depression. Guaranteed. And stuffs the coffers of the pharmaceutical companies full, doesn't it? And the doctors, etc. It's a gold mine for them. But doesn't cure at all. In the modern swamis, the psychiatrists, you know, they mean well, but they don't have the tools really. They turned them to medicine most. I mean, it used to be psychotherapy when I grew up, before antidepressants really, you know, what we had basically was Valium back then. A lot of people were on Valium, I'll tell you that. Booze and Valium, I'm not supposed to mix the two, but a lot of people medicate with booze, Valium. Sometimes they mix the two, it's a bad thing. And psychotherapy, talk therapy. So, but they basically just kind of listen to you and were quiet, and how does that make you feel? They didn't really have the tools. They don't have the tools. They don't have the tools that we have right now. We have here fourth phase. In your fourth phase, you have the tools to succeed. Have the tools. So this is beyond psychiatry, beyond psychology. The culture of spiritual attainment transcends the whole Western paradigm, okay, of mental health treatment and all that. The world is inherently repulsive to us, absolutely. You shouldn't pretend otherwise, you know. It was a culture where frantically trying to have fun. Well, you know, as the song goes, we'll have fun till our daddy takes the T-bird away. You know? And then you get depression. And then you get pharmaceuticals. Go to a psychiatrist, you know. Okay, we can treat that. Here you go. Whoops, it's not working so well. We've got to up the dosage. Let's try another one. Let's try another one. Are we having bad dream side effects? Let's try another. Let's try another. Many people are going through that grinder, as I did. So I'm very much compassionate and aware of this entire situation concerning anxiety, sleeplessness, depression, angst, negativity, misery, revulsion, all this stuff. I've lived it, absolutely, totally been immersed in, lived it. And these techniques, these practices which the Holy Spirit is giving out to us now, this is the antidote, this is the way. But it's not a static way, it's not like an end in itself. It helps us get to the non-dual perspective of indeterminacy, spontaneity in the now, as Longchenpa calls it. You know, Dr. Longchenpa is quite a doctor, as is Dr. Jesus. You listen to those two doctors and you're listening to the gospel. Okay. And Sri Sri Anandamayi was the great witness to the truth of indeterminacy. Even this world is completely indeterminate. Okay, she was continuously miraculous life where everything around her, people realize it's all indeterminate. It was, you know, just constant stream of miracles. This is just astonishing. People are just completely astonished. You know, just like wherever you go, no matter what, everything just happens exactly the way you need it to happen. What's going on here? If you're holding a meditation and the rain is pouring down, the monsoon's pouring down, and the roof is going to collapse, and you decide, well, I want to finish the meditation, the roof doesn't collapse. You leave the meditation hall, when you're done, you get outside, everyone's outside, poof, the roof collapses. Non-stop display of evidence of indeterminacy. The nature of reality is completely indeterminate. There is no causation whatsoever. Each moment is completely spontaneously self-released in the now, free and clear of all other moments. Nothing determines anything else. So we had this example in the world, in most of the 20th century, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, who, her whole life was miraculous if you just paid attention to it. Raising people from the dead, raising herself from the dead, doing, you know, just bilocating miraculous stuff, just going on nonstop, subtle, not drawing attention, not trying to say, hey, look at this. It's just automatically happening, because she knew this all is indeterminate. No determinacy whatsoever. So this was the witness to the teachings of Longchenpa and Jesus, pointing out that they're accurate. We have the evidence, you know, empirical evidence, we have it. You can't say they're a scientist if they ignore the evidence that is available. So I just paid attention to the evidence, and I said, wow, this is evidence, no question about it. Multiplying food, well, no matter how many people came, the food never ran out. And people say, oh, we have just 5 oranges, or never ran out. All this stuff was happening in the 20th century. And again, Jesus also gave proof of indeterminacy 2,000 years ago. Constantly giving proof of indeterminacy, right? But we have a modern empirical evidence for this modernistic scientific age. It's still the same truth, still same, it's completely indeterminate. People said she carried a portable paradise with her wherever she went and just stretched out for miles. If she's in an area, everything seemed to be quiet and calm down. It affected the entire area, a large radius. Arguments stopped. You know, just the whole, everybody just felt like, wow, what is this? Right? It's this powerful evidence of indeterminacy. But we're only allowed to give evidence of it in this world because we can't have it forced upon us and say, you know, we have to see the evidence for it and then change our belief system, because it is all indeterminate. We're just pretending it isn't. So it's not like anything has to be cured, because we're just pretending that it's determinate. It's actually not at all. So we can go to Dr. Jesus, we can go to Dr. Longchenpa with our despair, revulsion, and they'll say, of course, absolutely, not a problem. Very good, very good. Now you're seeing it, you know. and so we're not wiped out by this. So it's a very different path. The culture of spiritual attainment is the opposite path of the corporate princess culture that we're in, that is being run by a big pharma, and which has no techniques, no way to deal with this revulsion of the world except to take their medicines, take these compounds, yeah. Chemistry, you know. Mess with the brain, it's chemistry. As if you have some sort of chemical problem in your brain. Now we have an existential problem. with this trying to deny what we are is repulsive. And so it's not going to be solved except through spiritual techniques. The Holy Spirit gives us techniques. Jesus and Dr. Jesus, Dr. Longchenpa, explains it to us all. They give us techniques. They say, focus on this. We have to learn discipline. We have to use our will. And we have to be cured of this insanity, this denial of this attempt to change what we are. We have to drop this attempt in exchange for, as I say, supernature, a supernatural condition, indeterminacy. This is the way to be free of all this misery. So we bring the intention to bring the misery on. This is good practice. Good practice. This is great. Not afraid of it. So, if you're used to going to Dr. Jesus for therapy, it's not a surprise that Dr. Jesus shows up. Sometimes you're aware. Oh yeah, okay. Talking to Jesus, that's fine. Same thing if you go to some big shot. You know, a psychotherapist, and there's lots of big shot psychotherapists. Maybe not as big as they used to be. They used to be like everybody was looking for the therapist. Everyone's looking for a therapist. You know, if you weren't live back then, they were the rock stars. Okay, and it's like, who's your therapist? It's like super important. Instead of who's your guru, it was who's your therapist. Do you know a good therapist? Yeah. And you're supposed to be in therapy. I mean, intelligent upper-class people were supposed to be in therapy because it was like a mark of a great status, and who your therapist was really important. And now that's been transferred over to some of these teachers, spiritual teachers in some way. They're still, you know, seeing, you know, therapists, and it's still a status thing. Who's your guru? Who's your therapist? So you might have a really, you know, top-notch famous therapist if you have the money and the connections to be accepted by this therapist. And so you go see them every week, sometimes twice a week, three times a week, it depends how much money you have. You know them, they're your friend. You might be seeing them for 20 years and you might socialize with them. You know, you're in the same circles, and so you might say to somebody, oh yeah, I was just talking with my therapist and such and such. They say, what, you know them? Oh my gosh, really? Oh, I couldn't even be in their presence. Are you kidding? This is like some ultimate shaman, you know. So if you spend your time in therapy with Dr. Jesus, then of course when you have a talk with Dr. Jesus, You say, okay, Dr. Jesus invited me to his place. It's like, okay, it's no big deal. I mean, it's great, but it's therapist. Dr. Jesus is a, you know, super therapist. Gives us all sorts of practices. It says, try this, try this, try this. I deeply and with great love recommend that you give serious consideration to using this. And please, I ask you to try this. You know, it's really very, very, you know, this awesome therapist, actually. And Longchenpa also has this feel. It comes through, it was conveyed. And he's saying, please, you know, listen to what I'm saying here. Hear what I'm saying. I'm telling you the truth. This is how to be, you know, liberated. So, again, I come back from the roots of a culture where therapy was, you know, extremely prevalent. And you're supposed to be in therapy. We all have neuroses, hang-ups. We're all neurotic, as it were, have neuroses. So we're supposed to be actively working on this. And it just happened that I was so willing to do this that I got a great therapist. And a second one has joined in now, too. And so there's nothing strange for me at all. These days, it's all about pills. Back then, there's no pills. you go to a therapist. Find a therapist. Go visit the therapist's office or house. I had all sorts of therapists and tried different therapies. And, you know, he's working on your fears, your anxieties. It really is working on, like, I hate this world. I really hate this world. And you're trying to, you know, everybody says you're supposed to love this world. I say, I hate this world. This place is just repulsive. The whole premise of this world is repulsive. And they say, well, oh, that's a problem. You're supposed to be better adjusted to this world. They all have different theories, you know, all sorts of theories. But, you know, Jesus tells us straight, Longchenpa tells us straight. He says, yeah, there's nothing of value in this world. Absolutely nothing of value. Drop your value on this world. Totally. Don't make a single exception or exemption whatsoever. Pure, unequivocal, no valuing of this world. Ah, thank you. So he agrees with you. Yeah, absolutely. This world does not remind you of reality or your true identity in the slightest bit. Not in any way does it remind you. In fact, it says just the opposite. Just the opposite. It says you are not a body. Never been a body, never will be a body. The body is the primary defensive tool we use to try to deny and forget what we are. It has nothing to do with what we are whatsoever. Oh, so that's why you look at bodies, this has nothing to do with me whatsoever. Positive. See, Jesus would say, that's great. That's great. Now you're making progress, see? So, you know, lifetime of therapy. A lot of people from my generation and before, a little bit before my generation, it was assumed you'd be in a, you know, a lifetime of therapy. The upper middle class, you know, the intelligentsia and stuff, they figure, oh, you know, I'm going to be in therapy for my whole life, probably. I've got all sorts of hang-ups and neuroses and stuff, and it's difficult to untangle them. So, for me, I just said, you know, I'm just going to work at this and stay in therapy until I don't need it anymore. But I realized my therapists were not helping me. So I said, this is not working. And find a better therapist, got to find a better one. I read all the books of all the great therapists, you know, and just said, maybe this school, this lineage is this, and this school is right. And he just always hoping, you know, reading and trying to get some clue, get clued in is where are the great therapists? Where are the great therapists? Where are the great therapists? And then looking then also for gurus, non-dual teachers. Where are the great therapists? Well, all the while I'm in therapy with Dr. Jesus. It's hard to understand, you know, how it's possible to succeed, because it seems so different than the worldly therapy that's being offered. So Jesus would say, you know, you're seeing the world like, wow, bodies, I don't want to see bodies at all. He says, that's not a hang-up. That's not a neurosis. That's sanity. He said, sanity. He says, now I want to help you adjust to your sanity. You need to adjust to your sanity, is what he would say. So try this, try practice this. Maybe. I don't know. There are different techniques. Full stop in the burn. Just be as indeterminacy. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. The thoughts about this world don't need this chain, concatenation of thoughts, trying to maintain an effort towards the world. For it's this effort itself which is causing the suffering. We keep thinking that no, this effort's necessary to make the world attractive, but actually, it's our own chaining of thoughts that is making us feel miserable. So it's like the cure we're using for the world is what's making us so miserable. Give no thought to the world at all. But the world does need to get back to therapy instead of pills. Pills are a dead end. There are situations where I don't know. I remember somebody came to me, someone who was several years younger than me when I was young. And he knew that I'd been suffered from depression, anxiety, and had been through a lot of troubles. He came to me for help. He was really desperately messed up. And I said, well, I tried to just be very indeterminate and trying to do the best I could with him. And I said, be careful of these antidepressants. I can't tell you what to do. I know for my case, I said, I'm off of them, and I'm just trying to work with this, you know, anxiety and be in therapy, and so I did the best I could, but it wasn't good enough, because he got, eventually he was incarcerated in a mental institution. Gave him so many drugs and everything, and he finally escaped from the lockdown institution he was in, and he hanged himself, went into the forest and hanged himself. But he was trying to force, you know, like many of us, he's finding the world is just horrible and was just desperately trying to figure a way to make it good, you know, make it attractive. And that drives you into a pit of despair. Maybe he thought, like, just get rid of my body, I'll get rid of all bodies, or something like that. You know, just so people do go off the deep end, and it could be that the drugs pushed him off the deep end. You know, I don't know. There's a question about that. Are antidepressants ever a good idea? I don't know. But whatever the case, certainly acquiring the necessary meditational skills is always a good idea. You can say that for sure. It's always a good idea. Because the more you do that, the higher your status goes in terms of therapists, you see. How I got hooked up with Dr. Jesus is because I had a tremendous willingness to study, to consider, to listen to points of view, that open mind to different points of view, willing to give him a fair hearing. I said, "Oh, okay, I'll give you a fair hearing. You deserve it." And so, you know, I had certain qualities that I was able to get in therapy with Dr. Jesus. And then Dr. Longchenpa came along, and I guess I've gotten far enough along in my therapy that I can get this additional boost, which is coming up almost on a year. I think it was November 4th when Longchenpa first made his presence known to me and transmitted this understanding of pure spaciousness. So it's been a year of great therapy, you know. Coming up, it's only about a little more than a week away. For the 1 year anniversary of that. Wow, time really flies. I was shocked to realize that. Good grief. So the truth is that the therapy of most cultures is not sufficient. Some cultures help more than others. There are cultures where people don't get so depressed. You know, certainly the West is epidemic, and the Silicon Valley is an epidemic for anxiety and depressive disorders. You know, and they're the ones who are supposed to be, you know, who are designing our future for everyone here in the world. And they're just, you know, have meltdowns here. Hardly anyone you'd want to have designing your future for you. That's for sure. So the disciplines of sitting still, not struggling, being indeterminate, not having any need to label anything, no questions, no answers, no labels, just all maybe, full stop and maybe-ness. Acquiring these habits and disciplines is extremely important for everyone in this world. Because the world is absolutely repulsive to everyone, actually. Seeing bodies is completely repulsive. There's no way around it. There's no way around that. And so you're going to run into depression. I mean, look at the funny man, Robin Williams, you see. Didn't have the tools. He thought that telling jokes was going to solve the problem. No, it doesn't solve the problem at all. You can't joke your way past this problem. You have to meditate your way past this problem. You have to full stop in the now your way past this issue. Evaporate it. So the best advice is just sit quietly, indeterminately. You know, don't try to come up with any answers. Don't try to come up with any questions. Get used to this indeterminacy, guess maybe. And of course you're going to be tense and a bit shocked and stunned and all this. But you're doing it purposefully. You're in control of it. And you're making lemonade out of it. So you feel positive. That's how I can keep on functioning out of this insane stress that I'm under. Sleeplessness has come back. It's coming back again. You know, the work has dried up again, the bills are before me again, all this stuff seems like incurable. But I said, okay, that's full stop in the now. And the repulsiveness, oh, yeah, the world is obviously horrible, great. You know, the body's falling apart, oh, great, what an awful place this world is, wonderful. Very positive recognition. Don't struggle with trying to make the world appear attractive. There is redemption for it. There is supernature. There is the vision of oneness. There is the presence of God, there is the feeling of indeterminacy. All that redeems the whole situation. So that's all there. It's all there. It's just that we're holding on to this chain, thinking, I need these thoughts. I need to always be thinking. I need to always be trying to solve this. No, there's nothing to solve. Just drop the, you know, set down the belief of determinacy. And so nothing, everything is then devoid of self-nature, as the Buddhists put it. So there isn't any actual appearances at all. There isn't this tree or this lake or this, no, not really. Everything is completely self-released in this perfect spontaneity, and now the inherent greatness of that. So there's just this feeling of this inherent bliss and grateful greatness, and there is a shift. There's a shift in how we experience the world, and there is this culture of attainment that's been going on for thousands of years, and it is this culture of attainment that has been under attack by mischief makers. I call them underclassmen. If you look at like the world, like high school, you know, you have the freshmen, sophomore, juniors, and seniors. The seniors are the upperclassmen, the true upperclassmen. And this world is like a situation where the freshmen and sophomores are rebelling against the seniors and pulling a lot of the juniors down into their rebellion and saying, hey, there is no such thing as graduation. You know, it's all crazy. Why? Because they feel that they don't have what it takes. They're impatient, and they feel they can't get to graduation. Be upperclassmen and graduate as a senior. So they want to kind of just do away with the whole notion of the whole situation. No culture of spiritual attainment. This is their goal. So there's very rebellious ones. The rebellious ones are here in this world now, and they're fomenting this rebellion against the culture of spiritual attainment. And being an upperclassman, myself being a senior, working myself through it all, starting out as a freshman, you know, going through the whole situation, you know, is a lot of work, but it's unavoidable. And you're supposed to have respect. The underclassmen are supposed to respect the upperclassmen. The upperclassmen are supposed to respect and help out the underclassmen. But you cannot have this rebellion trying to tear down the entire culture of spiritual attainment and replace it with pharmaceuticals, and, you know, including booze and drugs and sex, drugs, rock and roll, replace it with all of that, you see. Then there's no more respect. There's no more respect. So that's it's a terrible situation. And then therefore people get more and more depressed. More and more freaked out, more and more depressed. They don't see any way of dealing with it except to try and modify their chemistry, brain chemistry, and end up in the clutches of these mischief makers. At least from a standpoint of belief, no one's actually entrapped at all, but it can seem that way. So it's graduation time, you know, the senior class is ready to graduate. I'm ready to graduate. That's why Jesus invited me to his place. You know, that's like, maybe that's a graduation present or something like that. And the shame is not being able to disseminate that down through society, you know, because there's this rebellion that has happened on this planet. The rebellious ones have come to this planet and talked into the ear of the underclassmen, says, hey, why should you have to be, you know, feeling less than they are, go through the struggle and, you know, do all this work? You don't have to do that. Hey, look at these smartphones. Oh, that'll make you smart. Look at these gadgets we have here for you. You don't need to do this stuff. And, you know, the freshmen are feeling like, wow, I got so much, I have to go through so much. And, you know, and they think, oh, I don't have to do that. I can give me a smartphone and that's all I need. Oh, great! You know, and so they're easily, you know, convinced of that. But the seniors, of course, not tricked by that. not tricked by technology, not tricked by the rebellious ones and their glass beads. But certainly, so the whole culture of spiritual attainment level raised, you know. It's like the Roman legions raising Jerusalem. Destruction of the second temple. Was it Pompeii or Titus or something? But it was the Roman legions came in and completely razed the temple. And what they did was they cut down all the trees. Cut down every single tree and shrub and just left it a complete wasteland. A total wasteland, you see. Expelled all the Jews, just razed the whole countryside, literally. Can you imagine that? Someone coming into your valley and cutting down every single tree, taking a chainsaw to every tree, every bush, burning all the houses, and look at it later, just a desert, a complete wasteland. Yeah, how that would feel? Yeah, that's what happened. Why? So they wouldn't seem so lowly in their own eyes. So their own lowliness would not seem so terrible in contrast to those who are not so lowly. They want to tear down what, so they don't feel the bite of the contrast so much. See, this is the problem. So the underclassmen think, hey, let's tear down the whole ideal of spiritual attainment so we don't feel so lowly here. It's just like, let's lower the bar and get rid of the bar altogether. This is stupid. It leads people into depression, suicide, hooked on pharmaceuticals, and just a very depraved culture. So it's difficult to say what is the outcome, and how do we reestablish this trust and this. It's difficult to you need. When you're starting out as a freshman, phase one, you need the love and support of a culture, and because this is going to be difficult for you, and you need to feel like you're part of something that's great, and eventually you will succeed. And that from my whole life I was this way. I said, always looking at the upperclassmen, the ones who graduated, and feeling like the utmost respect for them, and say, someday I'm going to get there too. So respect the whole tradition, the whole situation. Respect it. Don't have to agree with all of it, but respect the overall tradition of it. And absolutely, super important. Took it absolutely, totally serious about it. But when that's gone, what will you turn to? Drugs. I mean, turn you, right? No discipline, no good habits, no respect, no culture. Boy, you're really in a dark cave then. And eventually you have to come out of the cave. And you can sit in the cave and blame others as much as you want. You're still going to be in the cave. You're still going to be miserable. So this world of this disbelief and this mirage of determinacy is like a dark cave. So of course we're going to say, I hate this dark cave. This is awful. No, not attractive at all to me. When you're in the dark cave, you play all these games of attraction, thinking, I love this dark cave. It's so attractive to me. You're really attractive. I find you attractive. You find me attractive. Oh, yeah, great. We're so attracted to one another. And now we know we're not. No, not at all. You start to realize all these relationships everyone has. Nobody's really attracted to one another. Not really. But this is like in the cave, they're all shaking with fears. Oh my God, I'm so afraid of realizing I can't stand this cave. I'm going to have to come out of this cave. So they play all these games of attraction. And it's all pretense. It's all pretense. I used to see this, all the relationships I saw going like, so this is all pretense. Everyone's pretending. What is this nonsense? You don't have to do that. Practice. Don't pretend. Practice. Stop putting all your currency into pretense. Put it into practice. Don't pretend that somebody's attractive. Nobody's attractive. Put it, don't put your effort in, not into pretense, but into practice. Put all your effort into practice. And eventually, everything will have this inherent dynamic of pure greatness and spontaneity and self-releasedness and bliss. And they all will feel that way. And you will no longer be bedeviled by this hellish darkness that we have been cowering in. Again, to draw upon the life of Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, who was this great witness and example, giving empirical evidence of all this. You know, she said, look, to tell you the truth, the feeling and experience I get when I look at dog crap is exactly the same as when I look at my husband. No difference whatsoever. Or to you, look at you, or to a cloud, or to anything. It's all God. It's all inherent spaciousness. It's all pure spaciousness. It's all self-released spontaneity in the now. It's all completely indeterminate. It's all has the inherent greatness of the nature of reality. It's all equal, you see. It's all equal. So you have this bliss. Nothing affects it. And that's the remedy for depression, actually. It's the only remedy there is. And if we don't, if there's not a culture of attainment to reach that remedy, then where does that leave people? Leaves them fright, shock. So I tried to bring a culture of spiritual attainment into the world by highlighting these great teachers and saints. Hey, pay attention to them. Nobody pays attention to them. I tried. The people say, oh, yeah, oh, look what a beautiful woman she is. I really like her smile or something. That's not enough. You have to realize the complete indeterminacy, what's really taking place there, and what's you really saying, what's you witnessing to, what's the pointing to, and then the teaching, you know, you have to get into therapy. You can't just say, oh, that's a nice looking lady. Wow, we love you, such a nice looking lady. You know, you got to get into therapy, intense therapy, and let it all, you know, sink in. Culture of attainment. So I was unable to be effective in the West. The pharmaceutical companies are too powerful. The whole culture of the rebellious ones is too powerful here. And it's you know, sweeping the globe. Everything is globalized now. So what do you do? I think you have to look for, expand the context and say maybe there's a bigger context, a culture of attainment. Maybe it's continuing on, not on this world, but on other worlds. And this world is just a little subset of this bigger stream. You know, maybe we're looking at this tributary, and there's actually a bigger stream going on. It's not just this world. It's many, many worlds, and it's way bigger and deeper than we know. And maybe we need to meet up with that bigger stream and realize that there's been a dam built upon this tributary. You know, there's been a dam, and this world is just a dam, so the river's not flowing anymore. That doesn't mean that the big river is dammed up. It just means that the rebellious ones have set up their camp here in this world. Now, it's true that those who are truly realized, they can manifest a body anywhere in the universe instantaneously. Thought is instantaneous. So, they can literally manifest a body any place in the universe. So the idea of traveling, moving an appearance about is not a problem for them at all. They can manifest an appearance anywhere. Or many places simultaneously, actually. So there's a bigger river. There's a bigger river than this world. So let us not despair that just because the rebellious ones who have thrown up a temporary dam in this world, we shouldn't let that get us down. Although if you were trying to prevent that, of course, it's not a very happy situation at all. basically saying, no, we must continue to view this repulsive world in a determinate way. We're determined to do so. And offering everybody the idea that they don't have to go through the spiritual path of attainment, you know, they don't have to do that. Giving a get out of jail free card, so to speak, like, just take our medicine and you'll be fine, don't worry. The ancient peoples understood that sickness was just an expression of our continuity fear expression that came from us. It didn't really come from nature at all. So they didn't treat you with drugs and all this. They treated you spiritually. You know, let's go through a meditation here. Let's find out what the burn is, and let's allow that to be evaporated, and then everything will be fine again, like that. See, ultimately, by doing this, you're detaching from this a belief system. Detaching, and you find it's okay to detach from this belief system. Now, the world will still have this belief system, but you don't have to share that belief system at all in order to be here. Because remember, here is indeterminate. The world is not determinate, it's indeterminate. So you have all these people believing it's determinate, and you say it's indeterminate. They say, well, you can't be here then. This is a determinate world, and you say you dwell in an indeterminate world, but you can't possibly be here. You don't belong here. This is the confusion they have. It's not determinate. This world is not determinate. Jesus says, I'm in the world, but not of it. Not of this belief system. It's like somebody in an insane asylum, and you come up to see them, they say, what's going on with you? They say, wait a minute, where's your boat? And I say, what do you mean, where's my boat? And they say, well, what do you mean, where's your boat? You're on this lake. You come to see me across this lake. How'd you get here? Where's your boat? I say, I don't have any boat. Well, what lake? And they say, what do you mean, what lake? I say, a lake. You're on a lake. And you have to say, well, I guess I walked on the water then to come see you. And I say, oh, wow, it really is a miracle, huh? Amazing. But there's no lake. It's like this world, there's no determinancy here at all. So they say, well, how are you dealing with this determinancy, you know? How are you managing that? There's nothing to manage at all. There isn't any determinancy to manage. So the questions of the insane, the dualists, are like insanity. They're asking you, well, how are you managing to do something? And you're not doing it at all. They say, well, you have to be. You have to be. And they get all confused and upset. And that can pull you out of the non-dual, you know, abidance, thinking, wow, yeah, how did I get here, you know, something, how did I manage? There's nothing to manage. How did I get rid of determinacy, you know? How did I push it aside? How can we push aside what doesn't exist? We didn't push anything aside. We didn't get rid of anything. We just stopped believing there was anything to get rid of. So this just really confuses, you know, those in therapy. They just, wow. So one has to have this good practice. It's better than just, you know, trying to get answers, because it'll just really be too much for you, you see. Because you're sure that there's a lake there, and you don't see any boat, yet here's somebody there. Where's their boat? And just say, I can't handle this, you know, I just can't handle this. So it's better to practice indeterminacy. So is there a boat there or not? Just say maybe. Is there a lake there or not? Just say maybe. Don't try to pin it down to determinacy. This is the road to health, mental health. So you might be saying, okay, well, wait a minute. How's this possible? Is it possible? You say, well, maybe it is. Maybe it isn't. Just abide in that indeterminacy right there. Full stop in that. Don't go any further. We're not practicing answers, we're practicing indeterminacy. Because that is the answer. That is the answer, you see. We're practicing the answer. The answer is not something that someone gives to you. The answer is something that you practice until you get used to it. You see, that's the secret to it. Just practice it. Practice indeterminacy. Even is the world repulsive? Maybe. Is it attractive? Maybe. Just practice indeterminacy. And then you won't need a concatenation, a chain of thought, a chain of questions, a chain of answers. You won't need any struggle at all. And to be able to realize it's all indeterminate, always has been. So you didn't get rid of anything. You didn't break any chain. You didn't do anything at all. The chain is here just this moment as an appearance. It doesn't determine the next moment. There doesn't have to be a chain. There doesn't have to be a chain there the next moment. So we don't have to break the chain. It's just that we don't want an appearance of a chain. The next moment there's no appearance of the chain. So nothing has to be figured out or answered or cured at all. Leaves. So just maybe, 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 maybe. I don't know, I don't know, I don't know. Maybe, maybe, maybe. Full stop in the maybe. And you may find like an intense, like itches occur somewhere. There's some crank here, 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 here. Just keep your hands folded down by your knees, and just don't itch, don't itch. Just continue your indeterminacy. So the price we pay is for trying to change what we are is this continuity trouble. And so we simply have to take the spiritual path of attainment. We have no way around it. There's no choice. And I know that so many people are desperate. They want to just take a pill at night and wake up the next morning feeling fine. And so, of course, they're attracted to a teacher who says, well, I went to bed one night feeling absolutely miserable, the next morning I woke up, and I'm sure. Yeah, totally. Now, it is theoretically possible to, as Eckhart Tolle said, drop the pain body overnight.
Yes, sir.
It's theory. But it only happens when the continuity fear has been evaporated to such an extraordinary extent that you finally drop the concatenation. You accept the indeterminacy. It's called in the Chan school of Buddhism, Chinese Buddhism, it's called sudden enlightenment. Sudden enlightenment. Other schools say gradual is the way. And then some say, well, it's both gradual and sudden. And after the sudden, there's a gradual acclimatization, et cetera, et cetera. But the thing is that in marketing this way, like I went to bed one night, woke up the next morning, everything, I felt fine. That ties in to the pharmaceutical mindset of the world. Now, maybe this is what Eckhart Tolle needed to do to get people to listen to what he had to say. Because if you teach gradualism, nobody's going to listen. Hardly anyone's going to listen to you, actually. Because we're all obsessed with the quick fix. Been there, I know exactly what that's like. Is you're desperate. You say, I just have to find some medicine or something that I take it tonight and I wake up the next morning and I feel the anxiety's gone. You know, this is like our frantic. When you have severe anxiety disorder, you're absolutely frantic that you wake up the next morning without it. Absolutely frantic for it. So anyone who promises you a pill or something, you're going to try it. You're going to try it. If Eckhart Tolle says, just come see me, and come to one of my, whatever you call them, symposium or get contact high. You know, you come there, and next morning you're gonna feel fine. You know, the implicitly, it said that you can get it right now through just a contact, just being around him, just seeing him. Well. That's pretty hopeful, isn't it? Now, when Eckhart Tolle came to like Santa Cruz, I didn't go see him. I couldn't afford it, for one thing. See, it was expensive, very expensive. And even if I could afford it, I don't think I would have gone. Because I was working with Dr. Jesus, my therapist. My therapist didn't say to go see Eckhart Tolle. Holy Spirit didn't say it, so I didn't go. I said, I gotta keep working. You know, it's not gonna happen just by a contact high. It might provide a boost, sure. But it's, it's wishful thinking to say that's all I have to do. Wishful thinking. It could be six of one, half a dozen of the other. It depends. It can be used as motivation. It can also easily be seen as some quick fix that is not really the cure at all. Like it's another type of medication. So coming from the culture that I came from and the awareness that I come from, like again, the life of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, is I understood how she worked and what her advice was, and she would leave people and say, I gotta go, and they say, no, you can't go, we've got this contact hive. She says, no, if I stay here, you're not going to practice, so you gotta practice. It says, let your angst of me not being here be the motivation for your practice. See, like that. So she didn't say contact high is going to do it. She says you have to put in the effort, put in the practice, and become, your life needs to become a life of practice, actually, right practice. This is the way. Now, someone like Eckhart Tolle could inspire that in you, help inspire, right? Sure. Lots of different, you can get inspiration in different places. But you still have to do it. You still have to do it. So, I mean, going to see Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, is that going to cure you? No. No. She wouldn't say that. She said, she might say, why'd you come to see me? You're supposed to be practicing law. As a matter of fact, a lot of times she said just that. People come from the West and go through this odyssey to come see her. And she'd say, you know, so why did you come see me? I'd say, well, I just want... She said, don't you have some spiritual practice? Don't you have some tradition? Don't you have, you know, in your country? You know, what are your prayers? She said, tell me your spiritual practice from where you live. What was it? Tell me what it was. Then they explain what it was. She goes, well, why'd you stop? Why'd you come to see me? Just keep doing it. Just increase it. And they say, well, I thought you could give me... And she says, no. You do stay within your own tradition and just make better efforts. Be more disciplined. Now go back home and get to work. So you wasted all this time traveling, this and that. You could have been practicing more and more intensely the whole time. So she did not advocate people come to see her, actually. People just did of their own accord, but she wasn't saying, hey, you really need to come see me. I want everyone to come see me. You never said that. She says, whoever comes, let them come. Whoever leaves, let them leave. It makes no difference to me. I'm not asking anyone to come. I'm not asking anyone to leave. But the advice, practice. Because the delusion is in our own mind. It's not going to vanish until we set it down, you know, exchange it. Exchange the belief system of determinacy for the belief system of indeterminacy. Exchange the belief system of nature for the belief system of supernature. Change the vision of separateness for the vision of oneness. You go in to see some meditator, been meditating for 20 years, you know, dedicated, and she'd just sit there, and then she'd say, you might want to try just a little adjustment here in your practice this way, a little adjustment. I think this would help you. You're doing really great. This will help you even more. And that's it. Just fine tune it. You know, fine tuning, like a mechanic. She's like a spiritual mechanic, sort of. Fixing, fine-tuning, give it a tune-up, say, here, just try this in this way just a little bit. So in a culture of spiritual attainment, you have these spiritual mechanics that come in and they go around and they help tune up your effort, for sure. But again, the contact can be a good, helpful thing, but not if it pulls you out of your practice. You should be inspired to, wow, I really need to keep working. Of course, again, when you have severe suffering, you're really looking for the quick fix, for sure. There's no question about it. Just give me the medicine. Just give me the mantra. Just give me whatever you give me. I just don't want to wake up the next morning feeling this way. Now, you know, I'm still, every day of my life, I wake up and I'm just extremely, extremely upset and disappointed that I still feel terrible. I say, I don't think I can go on another day feeling this way. I don't think it's possible. And I lie in bed for a long time just trying to convince myself that I can, you know, go on another day. So of course, when you wake up and you feel the anxiety floods back, and you know, from your dreams are gone, the anxiety floods back, and you just say, oh, this is horrible. I don't know if I can make it through another day. Of course you want the quick fix, absolutely. But, you know, there is no quick fix. There are practices which will diminish the anxiety for sure. So life isn't so terrible. The very fact that there are those who have freed themselves, who are free of it, and never will suffer ever again, should be great encouragement. The fact that there is a way to get free of it is great encouragement. And so you feel a little bit better, you feel a little bit better, like, wow, I won't feel this way forever. But take that away from a culture and what you got left with. Wow, I better do everything I possibly can to keep taking this medication and support research for more medication, right? Pour my money into healthcare. Which just subsidizes in the pharmaceutical industry. This whole healthcare thing is just absolute nightmare in so many ways. Dystopian. I do expect the blossoming of something situation near 215. We're very near 215 right now. That's what I was told to expect. So I do expect it. I don't know how it will take place, but I'm ready for it. And certainly, this the way the world's going is for dystopians entirely. You know, for the rebellious dystopians. This is what they want. So. Let's locate the bigger river, you know, of God's plan of salvation, and make sure that we're on that river. And they can dam up this world all they want to, which is what they're doing, but we're not going to allow ourselves to lose sight of the prize, lose sight of the in the East they call the Dharma, the river of God's plan of salvation, the river of grace, the river of salvation. Culture of spiritual attainment. We'll just shift the context into a bigger context. That's what we'll do. We're not going to allow ourselves to be pinned down in this little river here we call planet Earth that's been dammed up, like thinking, oh, woe is us, this is the end. And no, this is a little river, a little stream, actually. It's been dammed up. Some rebellious, eager beavers have dammed that little stream up. So what? Okay. But we're going to expand our awareness to the bigger picture. Bigger picture of tremendous, you know, death-free realm. Jesus has prepared a place. Maybe Amida Buddha. Many believe that Amida Buddha has a bliss world. And there's, you know, there's a wider context for sure. And just sort of expand our acceptance into this wider, bigger context. So this little trouble here in this world is just a little gnat. It's not, no big deal, no big deal. So maybe that will blossom in some way. We'll see. More evidence of indeterminism, you know, wider context, vision of oneness, presence of God. All of this is possible now. All of this is possible. So, again, you got lemons, make lemonade. Keep your discipline, keep your practice going. Don't struggle with the struggle, full stop in the burn. Don't struggle with the struggle, full stop in the burn. Indeterminate maybe-ness, indeterminate maybe, indeterminate maybe. And just keep practicing it. This evaporates the continuity fear, and your ability to expand your context will grow. so you will not feel so entrapped in this world situation. Okay? Great. Very great. That's it for this one.